Security intergovernmental organizations. I do hope we know more about that in 3 minutes. Please, go ahead.
Okay, so I've already been introduced, so we don't need that. So let's say that you're meeting somebody, a random person on the street, and you ask them about if they know these things, if they know the European Defense Agency, which is under the European Union, by the way, and the NATO, they would have at least probably an idea of what you're talking about, right? But if you talk to them about the ASEAN Regional Forum, or the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, or the NAPCI, do you think they would know about them? Probably they won't, right? A lot of international relations scholars define these security IGOs as talk shops, meaning that the states go there, they sit at the table, they talk a lot, but they hardly ever tackle any hard security issue. And this is true, and a lot of states are actually very dissatisfied with, you know, how things go in these security IGOs. But if they're dissatisfied, my question is, why do they still go there? Why do they still invest money and time in these security international organizations? So, we might need to rethink the way we think about security organizations. We might come from a Western point of view bias, because a lot of international security organizations which are created during or after the Cold War in the West were created to manage relationships among allies. So their aims are problem solving and preventive diplomacy, and the voting system, usually since there's trust among the members, is a majority-based voting system. On the other hand, the security institutions in East Asia might be created to manage relationships among possible rivals, which means that the aims are very different. The aims will be confidence building, collective criticism, and enmeshment. And the voting system, since there's lack of trust among the members, will be unanimity-based. And this is why they're talk shops, because it's very hard to decide something if it's unanimity-based, right? And the structure will also be very different. We will have on one side very formal security organizations and on the other side very informal security organizations. So what do we take away from that? It's true that institutions, security organizations in East Asia might be just talk shops, but actually talk shops might be exactly what we need to manage the power relationships in this region and to actually have a more prosperous and more stable East Asia in the future.